साउंड चेक करवा दिया था ना, अपने यहाँ तक आ रहा था ना।
Thank you. हेलो fourth institute lecture series. To begin the program, I would like to invite Dr. Uma Prasanna Hoda, Dean Academic Affairs, RJIIT, and Dr. Sanjeev S. Kathi, Director General of the Institute of Technology, and for tonight's lecture. Thank you, sir. Now I request Ms. Juhi Chatterjee, student of the first year, to present the bouquet and welcome our guest. Speaker Dr. Sanjeev S. Kathi, Director of Gender Diversity and Education, my dear faculty colleagues, staff and students, a very good evening to all. It's my privilege and honor to welcome you once again on the auspicious occasion of Fourth Institute Lecture Series. The aim of RJIIT Institute Lecture Series is to invite speakers from every walk of life. As an eminent historian, such as eminent historians, policymakers, technologists, and leading thinkers to share their ideas for overall growth and enrichment of students, faculty, and staff of the institute. In the past, we have witnessed the grand inauguration of Institute Lecture Series by Honorable Union Minister, Ministry of Textile and Ministry of Women and Child Development, Government of India, Srimati Smriti Jubin Irani. The inaugural lecture was delivered by Swami Manishanandji from Ramakrishna Mission Varanasi on the life of Swami Vivekananda. We have hosted Sri Prabhat Singh Ji, Chairman and Managing Director of Petronet Energy, to deliver the second institute lecture on the topic Golden Era of the Jai. The third lecture was delivered by Professor B.K. Patnaik, IIT Kanpur, on the topic Impact of Globalization on Science and Technology in the Institute. In its continuous endeavor, we are very pleased to have highly experienced person from industry, Dr. Sanjeev S. Kathi, today with us. On behalf of all RJIIT, I welcome you, sir. Also, I would like to thank you for accepting our request to give us thanks from your lady, very beautiful. I welcome all the students, faculty colleagues, and staff for attending this institute lecture. Today's lecture entitled as Green Energy, Challenges and Opportunities, which is the need of the day, and I am sure that it will be a moral booster for entire faculty of RJIIT. Thank you so much. Now I request Dr. Kavita Srivastava to give the formal introduction of today's
speaker. Thank you, Dr. Rathi. Good evening, everyone. Today we have Dr. Sanjeev S. Kathi with us, Prakriti is presenting the Director General at ONGC and his cyber team, where he is instrumental in leading research development and demonstration projects for implementing the OEC vision of harnessing science and technology to meet the national energy needs of tomorrow in a green and sustainable manner. He has over 35 years of diversified technical and manufacturing experience in the global chemical, petrochemical, and biopharma biotech industries. After achieving an outstanding academic record in India, including B.Tech Chemical Engineering Gold Medal at UDCT ICT and first rank in the Maharashtra State SSC Board, he moved to USA for higher studies. He holds a master's degree in chemical engineering from the University of Pittsburgh and a doctorate in chemical engineering from the University of Delaware. He also holds an MBA degree from Northwood University, Midland, Michigan. Prior to joining OEC, he has held key positions in leading US companies such as Dow and Genzyme, and was senior VP in Reliance in India for 5 years. He has expertise in wide spectrum of chemical and bioprocesses such as chemical reaction engineering, kinetics, catalysis, and reactor design, industrial mixing, process scale-up and troubleshooting, debottlenecking, and optimization, downstream processing and fermentation, chromatography and separation and process economics. He has broad experience in technology assessment and planning, opportunity and economic analysis, development and commercialization of technology, technology transfer and strategy formulation. Author of numerous papers, publications, and papers, he has co-authored a chapter on industrial mixing technology in Albright's Chemical Engineering Handbook. His academic and professional distinction has been recognized nationally and internationally by Glenbrook lectureships, fellowships, and numerous awards. He has been an endowed visiting professor at the Department of Chemical Technology and the University of Mumbai, and adjunct professor at the Master's College of Pharmacy and Health Science. He was awarded the Hutchinson Medal by the British Institute of Chemical Engineers in 1995. A fellow of the American Institute of Chemical Engineers, he is on the Industrial Advisory Board of the University of Massachusetts at Amherst. He is also a fellow of the Royal Society of Chemistry and fellow of Indian Institute of Chemical Engineers. He is a National Council member of the Indian Institute of Chemical Engineers and the Indian Desalination Association. He has been and continues to be an active member, chairman, and several national and international scientific technical advisory committees, both in government, MoPNG, MHRD, DCC, etc., and in professional organizations, and has given over 10 keynote addresses and panel lectures in the last 10 months. Please give him a big round of applause for his contribution. Today, Dr. Prakriti will speak about green energy challenges and opportunities. Now, I request Dr. Prakriti, please give us a speech. Thank you.
Thank you. at the point here. This might change your correct.
Hello. This my pleasure to be here at RGIPT. This has been in planning for almost 5 months when your director came and invited me in Delhi. And I had promised, as you all know, we are also part of MOPNG. So I thought this is a great idea to have more interaction and close collaboration. So I'm going to talk today about green energy, clean energy, challenges and opportunities. India's energy scenario as such. We are today third largest economy on a PPP basis. And on the nominal exchange rate, we are. So, accordingly, we also are third highest in energy consumption total. Third highest net energy importer because our production, this is the shortfall. Total energy production now you can see here, China has surpassed United States and we are fifth. This is energy production. And it's going to keep on growing. While the consumption, we are third. Same thing if you take any specific electricity production, we are not bad, we are third largest electricity producers in the world. And we should be proud of that. But as soon as we come to per capita basis, because of our huge population, we fall in developing countries, right? Also, our mix of our population is more urban now, 31% versus 17%. And urban population generally uses more energy than rural population. So, while the world is going to integrate something around, no, this is the last region. India's energy consumption has shot a lot more exponentially, and the reason for that is this. Two reasons why energy consumption goes up. Population is going up, and economic growth. Even if we check the population growth, we are still going to need economic growth and hence more energy. So those two things basically drive the national energy demand. So today, by region, if you see, this is now world energy demand. OECD or developed countries are predicted to have zero growth, more or less, in energy demand. All the growth is going to come from non-OECD now. And the three major sources today, coal, gas, and oil, are going to be about the same. Renewable, hydro, and all those things will become mainly about 20% by 2030. These are predictions by British Petroleum. You will get similar predictions from different countries. But if you take a little longer term, 100 years, solar will get almost 50% of the energy. That's why if it's a long term, it's going to slowly grow and so forth. And then again, this is the German Advisory Council on Global Change. So, but we are very fortunate, we have lots of solar radiation in India, which is like this of what we have. Here is a plot that shows how energy demand rises with development. GDP per capita is a good measure of development or standard of living. Okay? So, all the developing countries developed countries over here, they have typically followed this path. Up to a certain level, industrialization and personal mobility take off. You remember we started that journey only about 20 years ago when everybody had 2 wheelers, 3 wheelers, and 4 wheelers. In the 15th and 16th, 17th, even having a bicycle was sufficient. Now everybody wants a 4 wheeler. And that mobility and also industrialization started recently. That's why we are over here. Energy demand is going to go up significantly. Urbanization takes place and so forth. And then after a certain point, once you are in the developed country category, services dominate and actual energy demand remains more or less flat. If India is to follow the same path, it's not sustainable. There's not enough energy in the world for that. And so is this 83% of everybody wants a standard of living as well development. That's everybody's goal. We want better life. But that's unsustainable. We need to somehow decouple things to work. So we need to chart our own course. We leapfrog in efficient technology development, deployment. That's the only way it is a sustainable path. So we need to decouple from what everybody has done in the past and chart our own path, and not only just for us, we can be the leaders for all the non-OECD. That should be our vision and goal. Now, these are the words, leapfrogging, efficient technology, what am I talking about? So, let's see, leapfrogging, let me give you one example, leapfrogging in the 60s, these are the kind of books where predicting that battle to kill all humanity is over, Indian women possibly leap. What are more 200 more people, our population growth and so forth. And then we had Green Revolution. And today, I think since 1990s, India is self-sufficient in food. Our problems are in distribution and waste in the storage. We don't have proper distribution, we don't have proper processing and storage. That's the reason. But by and large, we are self-sufficient in food. And how this has been achieved is through technology. So technology is always game changing. This is the yield of US corn, but we are really little behind now. We are typically 1/3 of the world less in every crop in general. So double cross hybrids, single cross hybrids, and biotechnology. Everything is technology driven, and we have seen rise from about 20 bushels per acre to this is a 7-fold rise in the product. And that's what happened, and that's why we have Green Revolution. Right? So now let me ask you, what other leapfrogging did we do as a country in the last 20 years? And I would especially like the youngsters to answer that question, because this has happened in your life. What leapfrogging did we do in last 20 years? Very similar, that has affected each and every citizen of this country. Come on, you have to have some answer. Sorry?
It's pure science.
How is that affected with an evolution? The standard of living.
Simply the internet, like everyone has access to mobiles, computers nowadays.
That's not mobile as communication, that's more cell phone basically.
Basically the IT revolution.
Okay, basically the cell phone.
Yeah.
Introduction of the cell phone.
Yes.
Alright. What? India went straight from zero or some poor cell phone landlines per 10,000 population, and we had to wait 6 months to get a telephone line, landline. We simply bypassed that, leapfrog, and had latest cell phone technology, cell phones to everybody. India's penetration of the market was 95%, which means 95% of the people can afford and had cell phones. So that, I call that as a leapfrogging, that as a revolution. And it becomes even more important, it's not just the educated and so forth people. Remember, India's 50% population is illiterate, which means they cannot read and write. But everybody can listen and talk, except a small number of people who are dumb and deaf. Imagine how long was this communication cycle for a worker living, staying and working in a city like Mumbai, and sending a letter to some village. He cannot read right. There used to be scribes at post offices where he will go and dictate what he wants to send to his family. That will be written by the scribe, posted, that post will go to his house. His house most likely would have no literate members, so he will have to wait, invite teacher or priest to read it out to the family in his village. And then they will formulate an answer over deliberations of few days, then call the priest again. That priest will write the reply. That reply will come to the worker in the city. And then he will ask somebody to read it. And so you can see that cycle was 15 days. And how much loss it would have been in the communication, translation, reading, writing, all that stuff. That's a major revolution. It's the 50% of population which are out of instant, out of communication, or with such 15-20 days lag, now came into instant communication. I think that is the revolution, that's the leapfrogging. And we are looking for something similar in energy area. So again, I come back to this. We need efficient technology development and deployment with a sustainable path. So there are many such things that are in the works. There is no work, one solution right now. Gas hydrates is one potential. Gas hydrates can do what shale oil, shale gas did to the United States. US went from 50% import of energy to almost zero and possibly some export of energy with shale gas. Gas hydrates, if we harvest, have the potential to provide energy for 40 years, we will become independent of energy import. AC to DC conversion, if you go to DC based system, energy efficiency today, electricity produced is DC, which is converted to AC, transmitted, and at the other end, most of the time, it is to be used
DC appliances, but slowly we are using more and more DCs in all your TVs, laptops, cell phone charger, everything. And all the appliances that are AC can be converted in more efficient DC base. Fire fans, refrigerators, you name it. So if you go, we will save 15-20% on first conversion and another 15-20% on the second conversion in the last. So we would have 30-40% improvement in efficiency if we go from AC to DC. These are big ideas, big things that do take time. We are doing a lot of other things as well. But I thought I'll give you some example of what it means, what means leapfrogging and what is efficient technology. Okay. Electric power, again, we are pretty good growth and so forth, but still we are 1/4 of China today and 1/10 of the United States. So if we want to even get to the level of China, we need to quadruple our consumption of our production and production of electricity, consumption of electricity. Here is the installed power generation capacity. So everybody knows what are the. So everybody understands to have higher standard of living, we need more energy per capita. Also, what are the challenges? We have limited indigenous resources: coal, oil, gas, uranium. 80% is imported oil. Access to energy is inadequate. There is a big gap between urban and rural areas in terms of energy consumption. And we have inefficient and inadequate distribution system and delivery. In some areas, some states, the losses, transmission losses are 50-60%, and they are not necessarily technical. We need to address these challenges. Here are some of the efforts: development, use of indigenous energy resources and techniques, and strengthen energy R&D efforts, distributed generation and supply. This is going to be a major change between current energy versus renewable energy. Two words if you remember from this talk: distributed system, distributed supply, distributed production, and modular systems. Those are the two keywords. In power plant, we think we build 500 megawatt, 1000 megawatt. Those are the kind of thermal power plants that we are used to. Bigger is better in the traditional system. In renewable, that energy is distributed, be it solar or wind. Naturally, is same thing about bio. Whatever you are trying to harvest, you need to bring back. You cannot have mega plant in renewable energy. So it will be distributed. Local use, local usage and local. So that's a big difference between traditional energy versus renewable energy. So distributed system, distributed and modular system. Okay? And then conclusion, obviously we need both traditional as well as renewable if we need, and they need to complement each other. It's not going to happen like one day we stop all the traditional and so we need both. So green and clean technology of this is solar, wind, geothermal, nuclear, hydrogen, all those need to be developed, customized and implemented on massive scale if we want to meet this challenge. Overall, I think we are pretty good in terms of the solar radiation, good potential for wind, biomass-based availability more or less all over the country, and it is possible to get energy out of this and also have some of our traditional sources. Over time, the percentage of traditional will go down and the renewables will go up. Access and empowerment at grassroots level. This is going to be the other difference. I will talk about smart grids and mini grids, micro grids and all that. So again, distributed systems, local production and local consumption, and not dependent on some huge plant somewhere else. So that will also lead to empowerment and employment entrepreneurship at grassroots level. Here are some statistics, and government has given very aggressive targets on all of this. They are working pretty hard. So what are the challenges? Okay, everybody agrees we need renewables. What are the challenges? One is intermittent nature of availability. As you well know, solar is available 8, 10, 12 hours. For 8 months during rainy season, it's not there, and when you have some smog and so forth, again, the solar is not, solar radiation which are coming to your solar PV cells is not sufficient. So, there is a need for storage and hybrid. You need storage for solar because what to do for the rest of the storage of the electricity? Same with the wind. There is no fixed schedule for wind whenever it comes. So, storage becomes an important. So is bioenergy. This agricultural waste comes 2 or 3 times a year and only for 2 to 3 weeks. I cannot build a plant just for running for 2 to 3 weeks. I build plant continuously running. So, I have to store that whatever I am collecting and use it for the next 4 months or 6 months. So, in every area, storage of renewables, storage and then hybrid system, what if something goes wrong, I still need a backup of a regular traditional other thing that comes out in all this thing is that renewables have higher initial cost and less operating cost. Clear from solar radiation is free, but you need to put up, basically you have operating cost is cleaning and maintenance. You don't have fuel kind of thing. So solar radiation is free. So that's a big difference. That's kind of difference you have. You have high initial cost and then operating cost is rather low. I mean today I think solar is available, so you can produce at about 3 rupees per unit which is comparable to you. And that has happened because the cost of the solar panels has gone down. Emerging technology options and so forth. We also have limited infrastructure for whatever we produce. We don't have feeding back into the grid if you produce on your rooftop or in your area. There are also logistics and regulatory issues, what price you use, where you put in. And technical issues in grid balancing. Everybody puts in at one time and there is no, again, it's a storage problem. So, grid balancing is a challenge. And there is limited skill manpower and sales service, all those things are needed. We are addressing those, strengthen India centric R&D efforts, distributed generation and supply, hybrid systems, advanced storage technology, and complementary to the conventional solar. So here are some of the examples of where solar can make a difference. Air conditioner, water pump, all of these things are because this is a solar lantern which was picked up energy and at night it's providing power, providing light. And similar things. What? That this is bringing the, unfortunately right now the cost is high because we are not producing on a massive scale. We need to do this on a large and the cost will come down. And that will bring here to millions of rural. Here are some other applications of photovoltaic. But the other part, here are some solar dish cooker, box type solar cooker. So those things are coming in slowly. This is a solar steam cooking system at Mount Abu. And I think they prepare food for some 10,000 people based on solar energy. 10,000 people per day. solar thermal project which is in Spain and so forth. We are, at Energy Center putting 2 megawatt plant in Mehsana based on solar thermal. Let me talk a little bit about solar PV, and everybody thinks solar means solar PV, but there will be other component which is solar thermal. Solar PV, photovoltaics today, all the photovoltaic systems, basic systems come from China. All the solar panels are made in China, and so I think very little we can do in that at this stage. Solar thermal is the upcoming area in which you concentrate the solar rays using basically different arrangements. Receiver, tower, and then you generate power. And this goes to temperatures as high as 400, 500, that's what we are targeting. We are working on beam down technology, which will be first time in India. And this work is being done with BS. Different cross systems, panel reflector, and all of those technical things. So the thermal unique thing about it is if you use thermal to thermal, efficiency is 60%, which means 60% of incident solar energy is converted into useful energy. Versus solar PV, which is efficiency on an average is 15% to 17% of the solar system. And now on experimental basis, some people have gone to 20 to 24%, but then they are not commercially viable. So we are getting a huge increase in the efficiency if we go to solar thermal, and we recommend we should use solar thermal in all processes in our chemical, petrochemical, etc. industries. We are putting together a similar thing is to heat our crude oil as it is coming out of the ground to reduce its viscosity and pump it so we can less power and so forth. So for that we are planning a solar thermal system in one of our gas. Wind energy, again we are fourth largest installed wind power capacity, not bad, but then again wind is dependent on you have no guarantee when you will get this power. Again, it is southwest and north region. Here is a picture from this 4.2 megawatt digital Karnataka, and we will soon have it offshore. This is planned for Gujarat. Again, the limitation, technical limitation is the blade material, how long can we have the blade flexural strength and weight and all of those things. Because the diameter of the blade, more power you can generate. So, material, for those people working in materials, polymers, components, this is a challenge. Small hydro, again, we should harvest, make maximum use of wherever we can. And main problem in this in India is land acquisition. How do you acquire the land to put up even a small plant like this? All kinds of hurdles are there to harvest our hydro power. I think Himachal Pradesh is probably the leading state in India. But it can be implemented at lot of places in the Himalayan region. Geothermal, we are excited about doing things in Tuga Valley of Ladakh now with the Union Territory of Ladakh. Here is a combination of traditional and modern technology. This pan is just pedals this cycle that he has made. For 4 minutes he will give 4 hours of light. And this has been achieved by generator, most modern efficient lighting device, LED, and most modern storage device. Something like this, if you can see we can use our own, make our own power, and it will be also a good exercise. Right? So that's what I call Gandhian engineering. But again, this is rather expensive system to put together. You need a lot of this thing needs to be made into a simple box that anybody can use and fit, make it fit. Okay. Storage, I mentioned, is one of the major issues in all the renewable energy areas. And thermal, you can have thermal storage for CSP and process heating, which I mentioned already. And for energy storage, the battery storage, I think everybody is familiar. Smart grid technology. What is smart grid technology? There is a lot of definition and all that, but let me show you, this is smart grid technology. Yeah, wind generator, bringing power, electric vehicles. So this side are the producers and this side are the users. Right? So I can have photovoltaic rooftop or farm or baseline or whatever, hydraulic power, thermal power plant, nuclear, all of these will be in and they will be control, and then these are the user factories, homes, cities and offices. This is the mega step. But I think what we can do is have a smart mini grid even at a house, and then a development, and then a community kind of level, and then the national level. Right? So what does this smart grid do? If there is a solar rooftop power, it will get into this smart grid, will decide whether it will. Is any user needing this at home, or do I need to charge the electric vehicle? If not, what should I do? Should I put it in my battery storage? How full is my battery storage? Or should I feed it to the power grid? This is what is meant basically by smart grid. This will make the decision. Now, for this car, okay, I have come home. I don't need the car till tomorrow morning. Use low charging 6 hours, 8 hours, or use when the rates go down, all of that stuff. This is smart enough to know that. Or if I need fast charging, do it in 2 or 4 hours. That will be said over here. And the same thing you have, when do these people go? When should I charge from the grid? Okay. Power grids in many countries now, they have different charges depending on peak powers and non-peak and all that, just like we have a phone system. So, smart mini grid will say, hey, now I don't have this solar right now, I need about this much consumption and I have only this much battery storage right now. Rates have come down, I will go and put it in the storage. Right? So, that is one thing. And then, now I'm getting a lot of energy, my storage is full, then I have to put it in the grid. Or the grid will say, oh, okay, I got a whole lot, I don't need it. Tomorrow looks like a good sunshine, very good prediction, and I'm getting good peak power, so I should feed it to the grid to make money at the higher rates. So I feed from my battery storage plant. And all these decisions will be made by the smart. And the same thing will, now there will be housing like 50 houses, then the next community and all of that. So my mini grid, mini, micro, mini, mega, mega next scale, and then the mega national grid. Like that, and they all will communicate with each other, and all the data will be available to everybody. Like, there is maximum consumption on this. And it will be sustainable development, here are the emerging options. Hydrogen, I think, is the long-term future. So not only for India, but for the world, because that is the ultimate carbonless fuel. There is no carbon as long as you are putting renewable energy to make that. There is no carbon, and that's what over long term this will happen, maybe 20-30 years down the road. Thermochemical splitting of water, fuel cells, transport sector, fuel cells basically for transportation, stationary things, including mobile towers, distributed generation, and biotechnology. These are the three mega trends we want to say. Transition to hydrogen energy is not going to happen. Remember how long it took to go from fuel to coal to oil. Now we are here, we are going more and more gas, and then hydrogen is the ultimate. So this electric, we already are going from petrol diesel to CNG based things, CNG based automobiles. Intermediate stage will be electric and hybrid vehicles. Biofuel synthetic fuel, and ultimate is hydrogen based mobile as well as power grid. And this already is reality at many headquarters of Google and all that business that is not hybrid. It will take time, as I said. These are the steps. We are building the market slowly, then building infrastructure another 15-20 years, and then hydrogen economy another 10 years. Okay, so what is this hydrogen energy? Remember, hydrogen is just an energy carrier, it is not energy. You have to supply energy to make hydrogen, and then you combine it with oxygen fuel cell to get back that thing. Again, it's the same thing. We are getting 1 liter of gasoline, but that energy has come over millions of years, or the areas we are getting out of the oil. It's a storage. Okay, oil is a very concentrated form of energy that is very useful. Same coal and soap. So hydrogen is not energy. Convenient storage. Now you can make that this energy solar, geothermal, or traditional. You can start with the traditional, make this, you build the infrastructure, then go slowly towards any other. All options are covered. Now the other thing in this happens is that this oxygen, today actually this process is meant to make pure oxygen, medical grade oxygen and all of that. Of course, if we go to hydrogen, you know, we'll make so much oxygen, we'll have to do something with it. Okay? So make note of that. This oxygen is more or less pure oxygen. On the other hand, fuel cells are not there. Not on oxygen. Reaction shows oxygen, but if you clear in fuel cells, you use air. So you don't need pure oxygen for this hydrogen. And this is the reaction. This is highly exothermic reaction, that's how you use that to make money. These are the thermochemical cycles. We are working on two cycles. One is copper chloride cycle, and we have international patented this. We are now going to pilot scale on this material challenges, and you can imagine. Then we are also working on iodine sulfur cycle. Here you need little higher temperatures. The heat needed is at higher temperature. Here is 450-600 degrees. These are yet to be commercialized worldwide. And we have now patents on this cycle also. Now, I want to mention where are the sources. Again, any source can be used. Nuclear, high temperature and all that. That's where all the atomic energy commissions, 5 atomic energy commissions in the world are working on it. I believe we are only private or non-nuclear people in this, but we are also working partly with VRC concept. Solar and other energy, any form of energy you can use to make hydrogen, it's also a convenient storage. There are a lot of technical challenges, and we have been working in this since 2007, and we have just come to batch scale small. Batch scale large, and now totally continuous recycle. Next step we have 12 tons per annum, and then 100 will be the demo, and then after. So it doesn't take place in one day. That's the point I'm trying to try 15 years. We have been working on it consistently. And here is a good example of how you can make some interesting protein. Closed loop cycle. close to highest cycle and then it is partially open to highest cycle. Now what is this partially open is we are taking H2S from refinery or any place and converting that into H2SO4 which is also used in refinery. And that we are commercializing first at our Mangalore demand and Mangalore refinery privately. So here are the steps for students, proof of principle experiments, these are batch scale ways we can do it. Then we are adding up these gas studies and so forth, measuring materials, optimize at this stage, then close lab scale engineering studies, mostly continuous. Then it will be scale up to further improvement pilot, pilot then demonstration. So that's the progress in R&D, it takes 10-12 years. But you can get patterns, you can implement some of those. Now some of the membranes that we have found are comparable to Navian, the gold standard. So we are going to try and commercial, we are going to set up separate companies for commercializing Navian equivalent. And we are already using it in 4 applications. You need the ecosystems, whole thing, because basically if you don't have hydrogen, so nobody wants to build the cars or trucks or whatever. We have done demonstrations at 2-wheelers, 3-wheelers, cars, trucks, Germany has done both trains and hydrogen. So those things are there, but it's really, you need all of these things before you can become a hydrogen economy. So, this ecosystem is very important and it takes time to develop because there is no demand, nobody is going to make hydrogen and because hydrogen is not available, so nobody is going to build a car for it, for it, for it, for it. It will go slowly. One way to start off with today, 70% of hydrogen can be blended with natural gas. At least if we start producing hydrogen, we have that immediate use without changing anything in the and then for hydrogen, you will need to modify the engine. So that's how these things will start. Here are our activities, copper chloride cycle, those is a lot of chemicals in here, the actual reactions. And I will just give some of these things. Sometimes this is the highest cycle. Here are the nuclear people, or the Japan Atomic Energy, Korea Atomic Energy, China, United States, and here is India, BRCN. I think on this we are comparable to world in terms of number of patents, both in here as well as this. Here are the facilities of IIT Cycle and IIT Delhi. This is open loop at IIT Dehradun. And this is the sulfur recovery we are marketing this as sulfur recovery for new generation. Once we demonstrate, we'll be free to license it. So instead of doing the standard group and sell it to Singapore and then buy it back for alkylation, we are going to do this internally. Alright, so cost is always a major factor, a major barrier in all of these things. Here are today's cost, 2018, USD per kg. Today we can make it for about $2 from natural gas. And the process is SMR process, that's the first time that we practice commercially today. Natural gas, if you want carbon capture and utilization, you put that carbon tax, then it goes up. Coal is also comparable. And renewable, if you try to do that, today costs are higher, about double or three of what the be. So nobody is going to put up a plant based on renewable for hydrogen. But long term, if we combine solar PV and onshore wind system, hydrogen cost, depending on the area, this is again from international organization and everything. Look at India, if you do that somewhere in Ladakh, the cost will be somewhere over here. Mehsana and like Rajasthan belt, so those costs will come down to 2 and those will be comparable. This is the prediction in the long run, and that's what we are working with. So cost will come down, cost will happen in certain areas where a lot of solar radiation can be common. I mentioned yes, we have proven it on 2 wheelers, 3 wheelers, buses, trucks, and all we have made a few vehicles for demonstration. So it can be done and it is possible to produce hydrogen based. Also we have HCNG, which is hydrogen. There are 2 stations available now in the that you can build. Again, cost will be comparable. So there is no cost at all. There is electric vehicle based on fuel cell. Let me just quickly mention about ONGC Energy Center. Was started in 2005 and first time it started in 2007. I think that's about the same time RGIT started. So our vision is harness science and technology to meet national energy needs of tomorrow in a clean and sustainable manner. What that basically means is that we are looking at all renewable energy areas. And we undertake our own in our own lab, assist, collaborate in research in clean and renewable technology. We have our facilities in Delhi, office in Delhi, Ahmedabad, Panvel, hydrogen project, uranium project, and so forth. I am coming back. Here are our major steps today. Hydrogen, thermochemical method, by testing water, we are also looking at high temperature electrolysis, and heat integration is one of our major, and materials, components, and equipment, and whatever we get suitable. Special properties and so on. We will spin out a startup for that technology and start. For example, lithium equivalent membrane. We also have some coatings that are very superior coatings that will go to non-solar applications as well. Biotechnology for energy. We are working on bio-CDM. We convert unrecovered oil, coal, lignite to methane, with some methane, cocktail of bacterial methane and other, and nutrient package and so forth. And we have implemented some of these biotechnology projects at 5 wells in Zaria, so I think it is more of a proven now. We will implement it in other areas and ready for life. Uranium, we are doing. Subsurface, we have found uranium in some of our well, now we are going back and so forth. So that will contribute to production of uranium using in situ leaching, which is chemical in situ leaching. And then going with the expertise to inject something and produce from the other well, so how to design those things and so forth. Here we are injecting either the bacterial concoction and or the nutrient package, and the bacteria do their job, produce gas from coal or oil or water, and then this is unrecoverable water, and that comes out from the producing land. So those are our expertise, and the same thing is in uranium as well, which is doing in situ leaching, and the leach solution will be produced, and that will be given to uranium UCR, uranium cancer. And there are others we are looking at, geothermal in Mehsana as well as in Ladakh area. And then many energy efficiency recovery is going to solar thermal, we really believe in collaboration here, current collaboration. IIT, CSI lab, ONGC has its own lab compared to the traditional. So, this Institute for Reservoir Technology is well as reservoir and conservation and so forth. We work with Department of Atomic Energy. We work and branches, DRC, Heavy Water Board, IT Council, Kapkam, and so forth. And IITs, universities, ICT, Pune, and so forth. And other research institutions, TERI, ARI, RCR, and so on. We collaborate, we have our own land, and we are collaborators, we are not a funding agency. That's the distinction between academics who think that we are not a funding agency. We have a handsome approach to discuss things, review regularly, give ideas, suggest what should be done in the project. So we are actually collaborators. So we sponsor and collaborate with appropriate projects of our interest and with our interest. Then we are more than happy to be invested partners of your proposals to DSP, DBT, etc. We also have some, we are working on some Indo-US and Indo-Korean kind of collaboration where there is one industry and academic in India and one industry in academic in Japan. We welcome to participation in those kind of things and of course in Belgium. Here are emerging areas, same gas, gas hydrate, but we are looking more at micro regional gas generation. Helium is one of the key strategic elements. We are 100% importing today. Helium it has been useful or needed for all your MRI machine, NMR, and so on. And we are totally and have nuclear applications and also in the system. Recovery of rare materials, just like uranium, we have found a lot of rare materials. As you know, China controls 90% of the rare. And those are all needed in all the modern gadgets as well as the defense area. And we are working on that. Alternate storage, we are working on palladium redox, low batteries, and higher flow batteries, recovery of lithium ion, and so forth. So, let me summarize. I summarized my philosophy here. But let me say how it should work. We need to have a mindset. We need to go away from delay. We have done my job, I have done fundamentals, and take whatever is done and do whatever they want of to a tango which works closely, what industry wants, what academic wants, and work closely. That's our mode of operation. We strongly, we definitely believe in public private partnerships. And actually, if we want to do something in the gas hydrate or those mega or mini grids or AC to DC, we need something like this symphony orchestra. We need lots of disciplines, more and more disciplines, all kinds of disciplines, like biomechanics or gas hydrate. There are 15 institutions, academic and industry, international partners, and that is the kind of effort that we need if we want to take the gas service forward. So this is the kind of symphony you need to have our own skills, but eight different disciplines need to come together for gas hydrate. Just an example, same thing in biomechanics, same thing in problems have become more complicated than what they are. But I think we need to have a change and it is I have done my part now. I go on to something else. We need to go more from fundamentals to apply to kind of research. So let me just go back. If I have to say this is four quadrants, basic versus applied research, this will be my answer. Basic versus applied research, low basic, then low applications, high applications, low quest for fundamentals and high quest of fundamentals. So we want to be in this quadrant and see where we are. Let's see what are the ideas, what are these three by four quadrants. high fundamentals but low applicability means Bohr, he was working on all the atoms, electrons and how they run around, and so pure breadth of knowledge, but the Nobel Prize and all. But at that time there was no application, no use, he had no concept of what is going to be for pure knowledge. On the other hand, here is Edison, all practical, no fundamentals. He tested 1200 filaments before he commenced his 1 lakh watt and that's the light bulb. Within 2 years, 2 to 5 years, all the United States started using his plan. And that's called Edisonian approach. Try a whole bunch of things, something is going to work, until something works, I'm going to keep on working, I'm not going to pay much attention to the funding. And here we have users use inspired basic research. Is Pascal Quant. Louis Pascal is the one who came up with the idea of innovation. Remember, this is 100 years of new biotechnology also was not known. We take something back at a smaller dose and develop immunity. Think of that concept. There are the problems that still was prevalent. But some people were not getting it, especially who were in touch with the cows and so forth, right? So he said, you know, they must be developing some, he came up with this. So there was immediate usage and high fundamentals. This is where all of us think we are, or we ought to go, this is our hope. But unfortunately, especially in India, we are just jumping around here. Some people may be going there and so forth. But we still haven't had a Nobel laureate for just to say where we are. So we are working here and maybe our approach, we have a lot of individuals class and we don't try to offend anybody, I apologize. I am giving you some picture here. We all think that we will work here and then jump over here so it will be useful for the country and so on. On the other hand, industry is working on what else can be done, what else will adjust from US to anywhere, and I don't think we are anywhere close to it. And this is academic, this is industry, there is very little communication. Maybe we should try going from here to here and then maybe go, maybe we should have less emphasis on fundamentals and more emphasis on horizontal. Let's go from here. First, you have to understand where you are and you all can. Here we go over here and then we go over there. Here it will be immediately useful for the people. So with that, I would like to again emphasize we need to work closely and on mega projects like a symphony orchestra. You can imagine if everybody starts doing their own thing, what will happen to the symphony orchestra? And this is what is happening at many of the mega projects. Many mega projects, why they are not posted is because everybody is doing their own thing. And this is, again, this is what needs to be, and with that, I would like to thank you. Thanks for the question.
Thank you, sir, for very informative lecture. Now I request Dr. Sanna Hoda, the institute of here, to conduct the question.
Now I take this opportunity to host this question answer session. Before I move to this question answer session, I would like to thank Dr. Patti for bringing this very pertinent issue of energy to the fore. In fact, most of us are well aware about this, and many of our colleagues and even some PhD students, they are working in doing research in areas related to energy and various energy forms and ways to store these and harvest these. Of course, sources, renewable sources like solar, wind, and all, they have provided us with some hope. But having said that, still we need to have technology that allow us to use this energy in an affordable manner. So we need to have technology, we need to have inventions. For example, most of these panels are limited to 51 solar cells. And power conversion efficiency is still limited to 15% around. So we need to have more energy harvesting materials and lot more research is required. So though there is hope, we still need to go quite some path before we can comfortably say, okay, that the radios are now going to take us through. Okay, so with that, I encourage the students and my colleagues, if there are some questions they can raise, and I hope Dr. Patil will be happy to address you.
Sir, can we get some information about that ivory sensor product that you were talking
about?
There are some slides that I skipped, but the reactions and so on, iodine sulfur cycle, and also I think we have filed patent or in the process of filing it. That is how you can get the full technical detail question. You are interested specifically in IS?
IS question.
There are technical challenges as well as other coordination challenges. Technically, main issue is that high pressure and very low temperature, minus 50, and they are at the seabed quite depth, at quite large depth. So there are two ways. One, if you reduce the pressure by bringing up slowly, the thing will come out, or you can supply heat at the same time. Now, we have got some samples and stored at the same conditions in one of our labs. Two issues, how are you going to get the methane out of the gas? Mass transfer and heat transfer is the issue. And where you are going to do it? Bringing it to the surface and then doing it at some offshore thing and all that being looked at or so forth? Or can we do this at the site itself? Again, if you supply heat too fast, you will have a blast. If you supply too slow, the production may be really slow. So there will be challenges with harvesting and utilization of the gas. Sorry? We are still hopeful. We are putting together now next program with maybe 10, say 15, say 15 thermodynamics, mass transfer rate, mechanical engineers, electrical engineers, host of pipeline, if you do it there or somewhere, or how you bring to the surface and then go back, all those things need to be solved. Okay?
Sir, we are aware about the smart grids from last decade, but it is not being commercialized in large scale. Still, we are having smart grids in some state, but why it is not being commercialized in large scale?
I think we have a technology. We just need to have the political will to do that.
I And sir, nowadays, recently, Bhadla Solar Park is bidding power at 2.44 per kilowatt hour. I think such a small units should be in all the states so that the consumer can get the power at no price.
I don't know exact details how they are producing power at that rate. How much subsidy did they get the land? How did they get the land? Land costs are huge because you need to put up those solar panels somewhere. Rooftop and so forth, but the rooftop potential is limited, you know. So whether they got any subsidies, whether they got any tax rebates, how did they get the land? Just don't go by just 2.44 rupees. I don't know the exact details. So, and again, there needs to be land here in rural areas, maybe much cheaper, or on the mountain tops where the panel land and so forth. Much easier than our big city. Well, I think power cost will be coming down. I showed you that hydrogen cost also will become comparable in the next 15-20 years.
So one last question. Sir, have you shown in the slide that how do the smart grids take a decision whether it has to send the energy to the power grids or the battery storage? So I want to know the difference now. How do the smart grid take a decision whether it has to send the energy to the battery storage or the power grids?
So you will have statistical data plus you put in your logic. You put in proper logic, this is the time hour, this is the thing, these are the rates at which I can sell, these are the rates at which I can buy. It will know the state of the storage system, is it full or is it empty. So that logic can be written down quite reasonably.
Okay.
Putting back into the grid, there needs to be some regulatory things and also the charge. Do we have the peak pricing power and all of that stuff to encourage solar?
Okay, now I think if you have any more questions, you can interact with him over the team. And now let's join me to thank Dr. Gaudi for giving our presentation. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Again, I would like to request Dr. Gaudi for presenting this talk and presenting this talk.
Spending the whole day with us, and also after having such a big discussion this morning, you still have so much of energy to deliver a talk. It's really wonderful, and thank you very much for that. And behalf of our director, who is an official too, because of that, he wouldn't be able to join us today. And nevertheless, on behalf of him and on behalf of Arti and Miki, I thank you for being here in the room. It's a wonderful talk for you. In India, we import more than 83% of crude oil, and also, you know, I read somewhere newspaper we started importing coal also to large extent. At the same time, we still talk about India is planning to finish the Paris Agreement in terms of coal extraction, right? Certainly, two contradictory states we have, but I'm sure a person like you who works for OEC, not only OEC, for the Indian nation, but your powers and listen, I'm sure India will be able to get energy independence and also be able to reduce the CO2 to the largest. Thank you so much for that. And one more thing, because you of the serving decades at PSA, decided to come back to India and serve India, your own country, and you want to help your own country. Again, thank you for that. Thank you so much, and I also thank all the audience and faculty members for joining us. Thank you so much.
Now we discuss politics.